Adam? Oh God! Oh God! No! Why did it have to be this way? I had so much to live for! They were gonna do a second Godzilla movie! And Ghidorah was gonna be in it! I really wanted to see him! Oh God! Science.
Host of this godforsaken episode of the podcast.
God help us all.
Oh no.
And joining me, because Bill is watching Doctor Who and so is Dylan, and Dave is Dave.
He's doing Dave things.
I'm here again, so of course he's gonna be gone.
We don't know. Well, we don't speak about Dave.
if we did speak about Dave, we'd be arrested.
Yes. but joining me is the wonderful Andres Perez, a.k.a. Kaiju Noir. Say hi, Kaiju Noir.
Hello, everybody, and rocket punch, mofos.
And joining us is the one and only man from Atomic Stick Figure Productions himself, Jacob Baker, the Kaiju Maker. Say hi, Jacob.
Shh, my common sense is tingling.
I love that Deadpool quote. I understood that reference.
I finally make one, you guys know.
Yep. There was some truth in that art.
Oh my God, when has it been the last time like any of us have quoted that?
I don't know.
I think that's that SOS in joke is about as old as JJ the Jet Plane.
And of course, it's because no one's here that we're doing it.
Of course, the one time where we have this like little patchwork of like this patchwork of a Sons of Serizawa recording cast that we end up bringing back a well-known beloved meme.
Exactly. What's hilarious was that the conversation I was having with Andres about tonight's episode was I was on my phone and I was too lazy to type everything out, so I just recorded my fucking voice and just sent it in the file, which I'm like, that technically takes way more work, Adam, than it does fucking typing it out, but whatever. And the first one was, he was like, it looks like it's just you and I for right now, Andres, and then he was like, okay, and then I was like, God help us all.
And just to let you know, while he was sending me these audio these audio responses, I was at the YMCA right about to clock out. I was right about to clock out for the day. And
so, yeah, the last one, wasn't it like the last one that I said, fucking invite him, fucking do it.
Because I had so I just clocked out at that moment, and I was about to press listen, and unknowingly I had my thumb on the button that increased the volume, the speaker volume. So I was at the front desk. I was standing next to the front desk, you know, where people come and go, like, at the entrance. And then I heard his voice, like, oh, damn it. Of all the times I could have unleashed the voice of Adam noise, it had to be in the middle of a YMCA with our children and parents present. Well, at least
one time I released the voice of Adam Noyce. It's at the YMC.
At least if anyone had anything to complain, at least I can say, well, hey guys, I'm off duty. whatever I do, I hold, it does not represent the views of the YMCA here.
However, it does very actively represent the views of the Sons of Serizawa podcast.
Shut up. the Sons of Hoosie McFuckit? No. At which point I just lower my head in shame and just walk out.
I always say that for whoever I don't know their last name, I'll go Hoosie McFuckit.
Yeah. It's very catchy.
It is.
Oh, by the way, when Adam was mentioning invite him, we were actually referring to a Mr. James Biggie, the writer of the independent comic Robot God Akamatsu, and he unfortunately he was too busy to be here today. But I was thinking it would have been so much fun to have him on for this week's recording, only because it would just make it even more of a hodgepodge of a recording cast.
It would be better if we didn't tell Bill about it.
Yeah, because because you know, we've been waiting to have our chance to, you know, to talk to Biggie again, but then, you know, Bill has been, like, you know, sitting on his fat ass eating pretzels instead of, you know, instead of, like, releasing the interview that we recorded with Jacob 2 months ago. I mean, at this point,
he's sitting on his ass eating one of the 4 pretzels that I bought for him yesterday with the gigantic ass cup of giant of Diet Coke, not regular Coke. He can't stand that. Soon as you say regular Coke, he just like faints and turns pale white.
Yeah, well, whiter than he already is.
Right, and he's pretty fucking white. And
and remember, he has to be diet because obviously he's trying to keep his figure.
Exactly.
He is in shape. Round is a shape.
He's like, hey man, I kept my figure from high school.
Excuse me, my double chins don't exactly agree with that statement.
Yeah, we don't.
I just got this disturbing mental image of these little faces on his chins.
Jose Garcia, do your duty. Jacob, did you ever see that image that I requested Jose to do? Where do you are you aware of Miley Cyrus's Wrecking Ball music video?
I've heard of it. I've just never seen it.
Okay, cool. Well, there's this particular shot where Miley Cyrus is swinging on a wrecking ball naked, and so I secretly requested Jose Garcia, who is the creator of Godzilla memes on Facebook, to Photoshop Bill's face onto Miley Cyrus and Photoshop out the wrecking ball and replace it with Adam's head.
Oh God!
And it is glorious.
Adam, do you still have that image?
I do.
Okay.
I still have
okay.
That image.
Send it to Jacob on Facebook right now.
Yeah, I'm going to. Because there was a conversation I was having with Patrick, the guy who made the Godzilla stop motion videos, Godzilla vs. Megan, Gamera. First off, totally awesome guy. Just a shout out to him. He's absolutely awesome to talk to and everything. Mm. But he was like, is that picture still around? I was like, I fucking have it. And I sent it, and everyone was like, hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Also, I forgot the reason why I brought up James Biggie in the first place was because I wanted to give a shout out to him because yesterday was his birthday. So,
was it?
Yeah.
Well, happy coming out of the womb day, Biggie.
Happy birthday, Biggie.
We love you, Biggie.
We love you so much. Now, please bring us Robot God Akamatsu Volume 2, please. Okay, so
give us more stuff.
More stuff. We demand more stuff.
God damn it.
Where do you think I'm going to get more giant robot comics? From the manga store? Hell no. They don't have jack shit. I mean, sure, they have, like, Gundam and Evangelion, but outside of that, it's all just blah.
Yeah, you know, that.
Yeah, it's got like, well, you're like your generic like high school romance drama, or your like Shonen Jump Naruto manga. No, fuck that. I want some giant robots. And so far, you've been the only one to provide me with the substance I need.
Jacob, Jacob. I sent it. I sent the picture to you on the Facebook, the Book of Faces.
Okay, now I've got to turn on my internet and hopefully it will run quickly this time.
Oh yeah, that's right. You're anti-technology.
Yes. Don't think any less of me because of that.
Less judgment is being shed.
You expect Adam to not pass judgment?
Yeah, I realized how stupid that was when I said that.
You expect Adam, the most judgmental being of all time?
The man who spent an entire podcast doing nothing but ranting.
Episode.
What episode was that? Because he tends to do that a lot.
That was the last one.
Hey.
I'm not sure. Oh, it's the one with the man who shall not be named. Him. Where I ranted about him.
Yeah, that. And then like way back early on, where there was like a debate between you and I about how I think it was back in an early episode of Shoewash where. You were ranting about like a movie about a teen pregnancy.
Oh yeah.
And then we kind of got into a heated debate over whether or not you need to write to your film's budget.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. I just saw this picture you sent me, and my two reactions. My initial reaction was complete and utter disgust, and my second reaction was, "I want this on a T-shirt."
Your first reaction was, I was scared. Your second reaction,
I wasn't afraid to die.
Yes. Those are probably the two most appropriate reactions to anything related to the Sons of Serizawa network.
I was scared and wasn't afraid to die. Those two reactions.
You know, people are either fear us or they love us.
Yeah, there's no really in between. We're kind of like the cancer.
Well, I wouldn't say.
So what you're saying is that I shouldn't hang out with you.
No. You have more than proved yourself to be one of us.
Jacob, cancer is fun.
Oh no. I can only imagine like someone who does have cancer is just watching listening to us in the hopes that you know our insanity would help him, you know, deal with it and deal with his cancer and then you are just straight up like insulting him.
Yeah, this is a little bit of a touchy subject because my uncle, who is a fan of mine, does have cancer.
Yeah, and then
so
I know
I'll just tell him not to watch this particular podcast.
Oh,
well, no, it's affected all of us. In all seriousness, wow, this just got dark. it is something that really is. It's definitely serious. I mean, I joke about it, but I mean,
well, so is diabetes, but that's become sort of a running gag.
Excuse me. Diabetes is a serious subject that needs to be taken care of extremely well. Diabetes is hilarious.
Pretty much what we're saying is we laugh to help us cope with life.
We laugh. We make fun of the stuff that, yeah, basically. That's the basic gist of the entire SOS. We are the parts of humanity that just are screaming to get out. But people are too afraid to say it.
Oh yeah. It was like in Chicago, after we got done watching the Godzilla movie at the Pickwick, mm-hmm. I was hanging out with Sarah Breidenbach and her boyfriend, Steve. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, yeah, you know, I'm the kind of guy who's over here and there could be like this really depressing subject going on. And I'm the one in the corner going, dead puppies, dead puppies, dead puppies, dead puppies.
Dead puppies, dead puppies. Dead puppies.
Speaking of which... So you, Jacob, you just got back from your trip to Chicago for like the theatrical premiere of Godzilla Battle Royale.
You just got back from the Windy City.
Yes, and it lives up to its name.
Yeah, it does.
Especially when we're on like the.
It really blows.
Oh. So how was the?
Really getting out there, man. I'm starting to feel uncomfortable. I mean, out of all the jokes that I've heard, that's the one that's making me say, enough is enough. No.
This come from this.
So how was it?
You? Yeah. This is me? Coming from the guy who just made a cancer joke.
But anyways, in all seriousness, yeah, how was the premiere, man? Tell us about it.
It was
a premiere.
It depends on who you talk to. You know, I mean, I thought it was fantastic. You know, we had, I'm going to say about a third of the Pickwick Theater filled, and that was not just, like, Godzilla fans. It was, like, half of it was, like, people that had, like, no inkling of what Godzilla was, and some of them had only seen, like, the new Legendary film. Mm-hmm.
And imagine. I'm sorry, I was just going to say, imagine if someone went into Battle Royale expecting it to be like, oh, the sequel's out already?
Jesus.
Sorry, go ahead.
It was just this great menagerie of just a bunch of random people that got together. And this finally completes my lifelong dream. Because I always wanted to see a movie that I worked on where I got to play Godzilla in a theater with more than 12 people that I personally did not know. So, life's goal checked off.
We applaud you, good sir.
Congratulations.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Congratulations.
God. somebody at school who is a huge fan, who actually turned out to be a big fan of mine, which was funny, which I was like, that's hilarious. And he knew I was doing Neon Genesis Evangelion, the retrospective, and all of a sudden I did something good, and he was like, congratulations, and I just gave him, like, the death glare. But, man, so I did have to say, it is up on YouTube, Godzilla Battle Royale, if you haven't seen it. Do check it out. It's awesome.
Okay, there's a bit of a pause.
Yeah,
there.
I was afraid. Like, are we having like a technical difficulty or something?
No. I was pausing for dramatic effect. And, no, it really is. It really is just balls to the walls, like Showa Godzilla fandomness that makes so many Godzilla references and so many different kaiju references throughout the entire thing that it's nothing but like a kaiju man's, like, wet dream. It is so funny how many references are in this.
And to date, it's really been the most ambitious Godzilla fan film we have seen, you know. I mean, we've had Godzilla X the Kaiju Killer, although I would say that in comparing Kaiju Killer to Battle Royale Kaiju Killer, try to keep things very small.
Yeah. Well, that's because they had, like, literally zero choice. But I just loved, and it's so funny because I'm now getting aware of G-Fest, getting ready for this year, or next year technically, and I'm seeing all these people, and I'm like, the one that always makes me laugh the most is seeing the interpreter.
Yeah.
Oh, Robert Scott Field.
Yeah, him. Every time I see him, I'm just like, fuck yeah!
When did you become aware of Robert, Adam?
I was watching an old interview with Akira Takarada before Godzilla 2014 came out. And Akira Takarada, he was saying something. He was asked a question of, would he be in another Godzilla movie? This was way before. Yeah. This was like a really good video. And he was like, would you be in another Godzilla video? And then he asked a question, or Akira Takarada gave his answer, and then Robert gave his answer, and he said he would love to be in another Godzilla film, as would I. I don't know, from that point onward, I was just like, this guy's awesome. And so I've seen him in other Godzilla videos, or not Godzilla videos, but like G-Fan videos.
G-Fest. Yeah, because he was the interpreter for the Koichi Kawakita panel.
Yeah, and I saw him, and I was like, is that the guy?
It's the guy.
Is that
it's
him?
The guy.
It's the dude.
It's the dude.
I'm going to take this opportunity to do my part to help promote Robert Scott Field, because he's actually interested in trying to start, he wants to be in the next Legendary Godzilla film. So I'm going to do a shout out for all of you guys out there listening to this podcast, all 12 of you, to actually help raise awareness to get Robert Scott Field in the next Legendary film.
Yeah, stop donating to this Facebooky bullshit. Donate like to him, Robert. Because to make him be in the next Godzilla movie. As I'm sitting here eating my Musketeers candy bar. America.
You know what? Speaking of America, you ever had like a time had one of those moments where you're just eating this really unhealthy thing that can only exist in America, and you look at yourself, and then you say, "Merca."
There was this thing they were serving up here. It was, and I'm not kidding, tomato sauce, bacon, and cheese. I'm not kidding.
I don't even know what that's.
Run through those.
I don't know what that's supposed to look like.
It looked amazing, Andres. It looked like the food of the gods.
Well,
it was just sitting there saying, "Adam, eat me, clog your arteries, Adam, eat me."
Because I recently.
And so I ate it.
The reason why I brought this up is because I saw two things recently this week. One was there was an announcement of Oreo churros. Churros.
That sends shivers up my spine.
I'm gonna look for an image right now. And then the other thing I saw was at Panda Express this week, and it was have any of you either of you eaten at a Panda Express?
No.
Okay. Well, like the main like thing, the most popular dish that they would serve is orange chicken. And what they now have is orange chicken with bacon.
That sounds amazing.
That does.
So I'm thinking to myself, okay, here's Pan Express. It's kind of like the Chinese equivalent of a Taco Bell, you know? Serving like kind of like some fattening Chinese food, you know, pseudo-Chinese food. And here we are, we're taking this dish that traditionally seen in Chinese restaurants, the orange chicken, and we Americanized the fuck out of it by adding bacon, as if we were saying, "Fuck you, this is our thing now. America!"
The only thing that could make bacon more American is adding football to it and more bacon. And you need to see, like, the grease just drip down the football and just, like, drip to the ground, and just a puddle of grease is there. And that, to me, sounds like the ultimate American food.
I just sent you guys a link to the Oreo churros. And this is covered by Time Magazine's website.
Oh my god, these things are delectable.
Not only is it Oreo churros, but with Oreo cookie cream dip.
Oh, this is so good, Andres. You know, the holiday season is never a good time, ladies and gentlemen, to lose weight. Because, one, you got Halloween, so you got a shit ton of candy, so diabetes. And then you got Thanksgiving, and then you got Christmas itself, if you're Christian. And just try not to lose weight during the holiday season. In fact, the rest of the year you should spend trying to lose weight just so you can gain it all back these 3 months of the year. I mean, that's what I'm doing. I mean, I
can imagine, like, like while everyone's, like, preparing the food and everyone's, like, feasting on it, I can hear, like, "Oh Fortuna" playing in the background. Da 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 da. Oh Fortuna.
Well, this has been a good episode.
Great.
That's it, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you.
Now
good
you
night.
Jinxed it.
Andres, that's my job. You should know this shit.
Of course.
He's like the opposite of Midas. Instead of everything he touched turning to gold, he just touches stuff and it turns to shit. He's admitted this several times.
Several times I have admitted that everything I touch turns to shit. And it's cheeks here in America.
The walls are covered in poo.
The walls are covered in shit.
To quote a line from Dumb and Dumber, "There's shit
everywhere! There's sun bears everywhere!"
Oh, yeah. When it comes to Toho Nation, Adam certainly has quite a reputation of turning stuff to shit over there.
Oh, did you like the lumberjack porn thing I did, Andre?
Yeah, although I think it would make more sense if you, like, you had put a caption on top saying, like, I'm Adam Noyes, and I support, and then there we go.
I don't know, but I like the randomness of the lumberjack.
Yeah, but no one's gonna get it.
No one's gonna get... For kids, Andres! For kids! You have to dumb it down for the kids to understand that lumberjack porn is something good for
but
society.
But if you just have your... you know, there's...
It's just as relevant and important as dinosaur porn, damn it.
Well, you know what? Yeah, there's no use discussing logic with you. So, yeah. No, it's just a losing battle.
Evangelion, Andres. Evangelion.
Ooh, I did want to go back to Jacob's trip to Chicago. I want to ask, what was it like being interviewed on TV?
Well, like I said, I was not prepared. I wasn't exactly nervous because, you know, in recent years I've become quite accustomed to, like, getting out in front of people and giving speeches. But, I mean, it was a very interesting ordeal. Just because there was so much stuff that were recorded that got cut out of the broadcast.
Right, that tends to be a thing. I
that usually is what happens.
Because they probably only have 4-minute segment to cover, and they probably have like a lot of, maybe 20 minutes of footage to cut through.
Yeah, I think we actually had a little bit more than 20 minutes.
Oh, I see.
But I mean, it was. I actually enjoyed the fact that I actually got to do some, like, behind-the-scenes tech stuff, because Billy was inside the Godzilla costume, and the cameraman and the anchor, whose name I unfortunately cannot remember, were outside of the garage. And we had the door closed, so I got to turn on this fog machine to fill up the doorway with fog. And then I got to raise the door from the inside, which was not easy, because there's no hand grip. And so, yeah, just raised up the garage door, and the smoke billowed out, and Billy stomped out and attacked the camera, and I'm like, yeah, I don't care if I'm in the suit or not. This is still awesome.
Oh, to be honest, it would be more awesome to see your suit as opposed to Billy's suit. No offense to Billy's suit, just that your suit is admittedly more awesome.
Yeah,
I think I'm offended for Billy.
Come on, you admit it. I bet you think to yourself. My suit's so much better. Why do you think you brought the last remains of the Godzilla suit, of the Hyper Godzilla suit, with you, just so you can show it off? See, yeah, check this out.
So yeah, him and Jacob and Bill get into a gentleman's dispute, and he's like, "Your mother's cooking tastes like ass." That's it. There's only one way to solve this. And they both get in their Godzilla costumes and just start battling it out.
Just recreate the ending of Tusk, but just dudes in Godzilla suits. Two suit actors enter. Two suit actors enter. One suit actor leaves.
Can't this be a movie?
A movie about competing suit actors?
That's actually something I wanted to do as like a G-Fest.
Yes!
Film.
You need to do that!
Yeah. Oh my
it's
god,
like,
yes!
like kind of like, you know, like, yeah, I have like those movies that are about like corporate drama and espionage, and it's just like one company, like one businessman going, trying to outdo another. But you have that, but with like,
yeah,
like the Social Network, but with suit actors.
But we
that's
need,
basically
yeah, we
the
need
rough
to have
draft
it, we
I
to
came up with.
It's really gritty, kind of like AMC style drama that's really gritty and like dead serious, and they have to be like drinking scotch and smoking cigars and in suits, some in like actual suit and ties before getting into the suits for some reason.
Dude, you're in a suit while wearing a suit.
Oh, God.
or out of nowhere when he's actually making the suit. It's just like that scene from Iron Man 1 when he's building his suit. You hear this, like, rock music playing in the background. Dun, 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 yes. Dun, 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 dun. For some reason,
why has nobody made it? You know what? Kevin Smith, fuck Moose Jaws. You're making this movie.
Except we demand.
Kevin Smith, I know you're listening to the Sons of Serizawa podcast.
Except he has no idea who I am, and he does not care.
Well, I'm sure he's a Godzilla fan.
Yeah.
He can donate a couple $1,000. That's chump change. That's chump change for him.
I mean, except the fact that he just literally ate his losses from Tusk with Donald Burgers.
I didn't mean anyone like my movie. he's actually at like, he's still hanging out at that same Clerks, like the same like department store from Clerks. He's just eating all the candy bars in there.
He's eating all the candy bars while wearing the Walrus costume.
I am the Walrus. Cuckoo, ka-choo.
Just a little. Just as a little bit of a shout out to the next review that I'm doing, which I just finished.
A shout out to yourself. How very Adam of you.
I know.
You are such a whore.
I am. Thank you. I make a lot of money standing on the streets. The next review is for Interstellar, and the first line of Interstellar, the review itself, is, that was so much better than Tusk.
Oh, really?
Oh, God.
Well, in terms of, like, upcoming projects, well, I know I keep saying that I'm gonna do stuff and then I never do them, but I do plan on coming having a little October wrap up review where I talk about two animated movies that I saw that no one else saw, Box Trolls and Book of Life, and I saw another movie.
I thought you were gonna say Mars Needs Moms.
It's funny. Everybody this month either saw like Dracula, Untold, Unchained, whatever. And what's the other one? That Gone Girl. You know, everybody saw those two movies. And what did I saw? I just saw like the animated movies that like pretty much like the majority of the public ignored.
That's because people look at you when you watch those movies and say, we have a future pedophile on our hands. Because he's watching nothing but these kids' movies. We're either looking at a future pedophile, or we're looking at a kid with zero childhood, and he's trying to make up for it in his poor, pathetic college life.
Hey, man, I need to support Book of Life, okay? As a Mexican, I must support my people's work.
That is the funniest thing I've ever heard.
You're Cuban, and you know it.
Like, it's true, I'm not really Mexican. I'm actually Puerto Rican. I've always wanted.
Here, have some crack cocaine.
I've always wanted to be a Mexican. At least then people would somewhat care about my ethnicity. I mean, who the heck knows about what a Puerto Rican is besides baseball?
Yeah.
But I also the third movie I really want to talk about is Birdman, because I've mentioned this on our last recording.
I'm going to see that, on Thursday.
Oh, thank God!
That.
And Jacob, Jacob, try and have you heard of Birdman?
Yeah, actually, my friend Billy and I were talking about it at his place. He had seen it, and the way he described it. It sounds like something that I really want to watch because it's, you know, it's not really a biopic, but it's sort of like, it talks about the mentality of people who actually play superheroes and like what the audience demands of them.
Yeah, and how they try to like satisfy, the demands of the public. Yeah. They're trying to do what they think makes other people happy in a way.
Yeah, it's kind of like playing like, a popular icon like Godzilla or something, and wearing the suit, and people are like, "You have to be Godzilla from now on."
But the thing is, this movie's like more like an exaggerated parody of Michael Keaton's own career, where
as Batman,
this is a flat-out parody of his career.
Imagine if Michael Keaton didn't know that he was completely unaware that this movie was completely shitting on him. Because in the movie, you know, in his character in the movie pretty much had, like, his career went downhill after giving up on the Birdman franchise. So imagine, like, Michael Keaton, he's in the theater watching this movie, and at which point it suddenly dawns on him, and he goes, wait a minute. Hey!
This seems eerily familiar.
These guys are making fun of me. And then he goes crazy and starts running through the streets in his underwear, like in the movie.
Oh, who doesn't?
I am so
do that?
Excited. Yeah, I know. Really, I mean, if you saw me yesterday, you'd see some shit.
But yeah, no, whatever you do, please, whatever you do, see Birdman. I know it's in very limited theaters, and so even if you have to, like, drive or, like, run, like, a marathon just to get to the nearest, like, big fancy theater that charges $15 for a single ticket, please do so. It's worth the money.
I want to hear about this full story, Andres. Have you told
the full story of what?
Of you going to see
Birdman. Well, it's not so much of a story because, you know, a story tends to have, like, conflict and there's not so nothing much in, like that here, but,
But this is an Andres story, and Andres is bullshitting, so...
When have I ever bullshit, Adam?
Whenever.
Like, every day of my life. Everything I've said about me is a lie. I'm not the squeaky clean, whitewashed Mexican that you guys think you know.
I live in a trailer down by the river.
No, I'm living in a van down by the river.
Thank you for catching me on that.
So basically...
I feel like such a podcaster right now because I'm sitting here talking to a computer... twirling a pen around with snacks in front of me, and I'm like, what am I doing with my life, Adam?
You're having an awesome fucking time. That's what you're doing.
I know. That's exactly what I'm saying. No, go ahead.
Birdman was out for about a week, and I heard a couple people talking about it, especially Biggie, who was, like, really into it. So I was like, okay, I want to get into it now. I want to watch this movie. And I see, like, there are no theaters around me that are playing, not even, like, downtown, which normally has, like, sort of limited releases like this. Like, the downtown theater, I think it was called the, what was it called? The Lamppost? Lampshade? I don't know, something that had, like, lamp in it. It's in downtown San Diego, and that's where I went to see Chef. The movie by Jon Favreau, which is amazing. So even that did not have Birdman. So I was like, okay. So then one of my classes, my professor talked about seeing Birdman, and she mentioned the theater in La Jolla. La Jolla being like this. La Jolla is kind of like the Beverly Hills of San Diego, where it's like, it's spelled like this, like J O L L A.
Okay,
La Jolla is like this really nice, very, very like high, one of those like upper class places where people live in, like rich people live in. And so there's this place there, I forgot its name at the moment, but it's a very, really nice theater. It's like, I've never really had experiences with nice theaters before, because all I had been to were like the AMC theater chains or like the Regal Crown Cinema. And they're very, like, you know, very commercialized, very, like, especially the AMC near closest to me, which is, like, 10 minutes away, a 10-minute drive from here. It's very dirty. You can tell there's, like, soda stains spilled all over the carpet. Like, it's so cheap, you know, it's so dirty that it's only, like, $6 a ticket, you know, there. Like, you know, not even matinee. Yeah. Like, all day, $6 tickets.
Excuse me, where I'm from, tickets are $7. And we have some high-class, like, 1930s-style theaters, Andres, so I would take that statement and shove it up your ass.
But what I'm saying is this is a really, like, cheap, like, low-class, you know, like, in any mom with, like...
I know what you're talking
about.
So
I went here to this fancy theater...
spelled R-E-S-T-E-R because...
I was about to say that. So this is like very fancy. It's $15, and then it was like another $10 for soda. You can't even refill the soda, so I'm like, what?
Jesus, oh my god.
But like
god.
The whole atmosphere was really nice, and they actually had theatrical re-releases, like limited re-releases of 2001 A Space Odyssey, and like some other movie. It was for some reason Saw. Oh yeah, and the Saw was another one. But Poltergeist apparently had a re-release during like this 1 week, I guess, because it was close to Halloween. And so I was like, whoa. And then they even had like a special upcoming event where it was like they're gonna show Inception, Memento, and 2001, Space Odyssey all together for
to get ready.
Yeah,
for
yeah, like a yeah. little That's yeah, like a little Christopher idea. Nolan yeah. event. And I was like, whoa. And so we and like other like a theater where you go in and pick any seat you want, you have to pay your and for a specific seat. In the theater, and the theater rooms are very much smaller, but it's much more roomier, and the screen itself is like curved.
Oh, it's a yeah, cinerama. Yeah. That's what that Ooh. Is. That's a cinerama. Oh, that's awesome, Andres. I actually envy you so much right now because I love cineramas. I've only been.
I was going to say that I envy both of you because you have theaters that you can actually watch movies in.
But the thing is, like, this is, theater was, like a half-hour drive away from here. So it's like, you know...
Oh, that's the closest theater to where I am, Andre, so...
Yeah, same here.
I guess I should be complaining then.
And you guys heard about my experiences with Godzilla.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. I tip my hat. We take our, like, hats off. And all of a sudden here, it's like in memory of Jacob's story.
A story that no one out there will ever hear.
Yep.
Because we didn't record that.
Where was I? Anyways, oh yeah.
You were at an awesome
the
theater.
The only Cinerama, yeah, the only Cinerama thing I've ever seen. And I got blessed. Was they were actually re-releasing the original first Cinerama movie,
roller
which was
coaster?
That like travelogue, the roller coaster thing. And I got to go to I got to see I can't remember the word for it.
Search the mental Rolodex. Come on.
I know that's exactly what I'm doing. I can see like the words scrolling in front of my eyes. Fuck. They just did it to the original Godzilla with Criterion. Restored it, thank you. They just restored, really, Adam? That's the fucking word you got a hard time with. But anyways, they restored it, and it was glorious, because they had the full surround sound hooked up, and they had, like, the theater, the, like, seats were hooked up to the sound, so, like, you could hear, like, you could feel the vibrations as you're going on the roller coaster and climbing it. And it was curved, and it was so awesome. So I really envy you, Andres, because seeing a movie like Birdman, which is supposed to be like one long
take.
Yeah,
well, it gives the illusion that it's one long take. Kind of like, pretty much exactly like Alfred Hitchcock's Rope.
Rope was the movie, because I was like, I was talking with Kyle today, and I was like, there's an Alfred Hitchcock movie where apparently they did that, and I couldn't remember the name of it. Thank you for
welcome. And I found the name of the theater. It's called the Arclight Cinema. So, yeah.
Arclight Theater, but cinema.
Oh, what was that, Jacob?
Said it's even got a badass name.
Anyone who's in the San Diego area, I highly recommend checking out the Arclight Cinema. It's a very hefty price, but it's totally worth it. And even before we watched the movie, an employee came out and said, hello, everyone. You're about to watch this film. Which stars this person, is directed by this person, and we hope you enjoy it. And please, if you would like, please stay tuned for our upcoming events with the Christopher Nolan stuff, blah blah blah. We recommend you please turn all cell phones off and place them. Please do not use them during the duration of the film. I was like, wow.
The Rialto Theater. I love how you're like so shocked at this. This is actually making me so homesick right now, because that's the Rialto Theater, which is where I first premiered Lake of Death. Does that? The owner comes out and says that for all the films that he plays. He comes out and he says, please shut off your phones. And he does this whole spiel about who directed the movie, who wrote it, and who's in it. And you're making me miss my...
Somewhere deep down in my heart, I still...
God, that's a really big callback. That was World War G.
Five? Four?
No, that was four. That was definitely
four. I still love Bryan Cranston.
Love you. definitely remove your handphone.
So, yeah, that was, like, my experience with Birdman. It's really a very unconventional movie. It feels very experimental, but in a good way. Where, you know, it's one of those things where it's like, yeah, it's one of those movies where it's like, it feels very fresh, very new, something like... It's. I've heard many film critics online who say this is why I go to see movies, you know, to see, you know, experience something fresh and new like this. And yeah, it's quite an experience. Unlike anything else. So yeah, highly recommend Birdman. I highly recommend any San Diegans or people in San Diego who love movies to check out the ArcLight Cinema.
I can tell you. See, I had that same reaction with Interstellar, mm-hmm. Andres. Seriously, that movie blew my mind. Both figuratively and literally.
There was brains everywhere.
How I'm even talking brains. Is quite a miracle. It's in and of itself.
Quite frankly, there's a giant gaping hole in my head that's not my mouth. And quite frankly, how I'm alive and breathing is beyond a miracle. There is a God. That's all I'll say. There is a God. And unfortunately, he kept me alive because he just didn't want me to go up there yet. And he did.
Oh, it's you.
Oh, God.
You know what?
Orson Welles go... Or you see, like, fat Orson Welles, like, waddling up to God and being like, don't let this fuck up. Yeah.
You already got one of me.
You already got one of me. And then you got Marlon Brando, and Marlon Brando...
Listen, you don't want to have this person here, okay? I eat all the pizza, I eat all the cake here in heaven. You don't want that guy, okay? There's not going to be enough food left for me.
You look like the walrus from Tusk, Marlon.
Up yours, Orson.
Why haven't we done that show yet of the misadventures of Orson and Marlon?
I don't know why we haven't done that show yet.
I'm gonna give you a piece of cake you can't refuse after I've taken 5 bites from it.
Yes, I would love an exquisite... What are you doing? Why are you eating my cake? It's stupid. I've had it. You're such a pest.
So you and I have had the same experience. We've both been cooking.
We've both been boiled alive, my friend. I,
yes,
by the studio
friend.
System, and you, by the chef. My, the French!
So somebody did a kind of parody of that, except for Stanley Kubrick directing Shelley Duvall from The Shining. And in case you don't know that story, he treated her terribly. And, so it's nothing but him screaming at her, like, every time she walks on frame, and they're on frame together, he just turns and just screams at her until she leaves.
Was it made by the same people who did the parody of Drunk Orson Welles commercial?
I don't think it is. I don't think it is. It is too bad, because all of a sudden, it's just great.
We know a remote farm in Lincolnshire. Cut! Wrong commercial, Orson! Yeah, every July.
I like the one where he think he dies.
Like, Rosebud.
Like...
like he brings.
Oh, did you like commensuration a thing on Genesis Evangelion Lamentation? Did you like how I kept your audio?
Yes.
Because I was like, this is.
I can only
good.
Imagine like people who are just there just for Evangelion. They probably don't even know what Orson Welles is. They just all of a sudden they hear my impersonation of Orson Welles. We know a remote farm in Lincolnshire where Mrs. Buckley lives. Every July, peas are grown there. And they're like, what? Mom, the French. Here's a California by Paul Masson. It's vintage dated.
Oh, God. Oh, the French. The French.
Leave me alone. It's my chicken. I brought it with me. I was going to eat it after this. It's not my fault, you know. If they really knew who I was, they would have let me direct the picture. I know how to deal with a difficult actor. Oh, Orson Welles.
Oh, Orson.
Jacob, have you seen the thing that we've been talking about for the last 5 minutes?
No, I have not, which is why I've been completely
okay, I'm
silent.
I'm going to send you a link right now. Someone did. Have you ever seen the commercial of drunk Orson Welles advertising wine? Okay, I'm going to send that to you right now first, because, you know, it's like this, he was during the last years of his life, he was just desperate for money and did a whole bunch of commercials advertising watches and stuff. And so,
Jacob.
You were going to say something, Adam?
Jacob. Yeah, I was going to say, Jacob, you're about to get a healthy dosage of internet right now.
Okay, so he's advertising a wine in this commercial, and all it is outtake. This video has is outtakes. And the moment you see Orson Welles there, you already see just how shit-faced he is.
Turn camera.
And how he has trouble delivering his lines. There you go. There's the link right there on Skype. And now...
Why not give me a moment to familiarize myself with the material at hand?
And now we wait. As the kaiju maker himself...
Now
as the kaiju maker himself familiarizes himself...
And I just don't even return.
Notice he sitting back in his chair, his chin. How he watches the internet screen, or the computer screen, extremely closely. As Orson Welles appears, completely... Andres, that deadly kiss on our hands.
Eagerly, Andres and Adam await his response.
Oh my god, he's dead!
Blessing is sick.
Oh my god, he's dead!
The last...
This is so sad, but so funny.
I just love it. Almost every take, he just starts with, "Mah, the French." Are we filming already?
Oh no, Doug Walker reviewed Interstellar. Oh no, it's not the nostalgia critic, it's Doug Walker. I like Doug Walker.
Yeah. You can tell, like, I bet you those two actors that he's working with in the commercial, I bet you they were at first, like, really excited to be working with him, and then you can see, like, that excitement slowly turning into dread and disappointment.
Now my memories of Orson Welles are ruined, thanks to you.
I can never look at Unicron the same way again.
No, actually, that's about how I met Unicron.
So just let me know when you're done with that video, and I'll send you the parody.
Oh, it just did.
Okay,
it did.
So here is the magnificently executed parody done by a channel called The Midnight Show.
Can hear the beeps.
Action,
Austin,
please.
He doesn't do anything.
Ah, the French champagne has always been celebrated for the There is a California champagne by Paul Masson, inspired by that same French
excellence.
There is a California champagne by Paul Masson, inspired by that same French excellence. It's fermented in the bottle and like the best French spirit, it's vintage dated.
I'm loving this.
California champagne.
Leave the silence in here too.
Leave my food alone.
So we can hear Jacob Baker's laughter. Speaking Speaking of which, Andre, you better make sure that we're still
recording. Yeah, we're recording.
Okay,
go ahead. We've both been boiled alive. I'm by the studio system. You, my book, Graciosa, tasty indeed. We know a little place where Mrs. Buckley is. Every July, peas grow.
Cut! What? The wrong commercial, Wallace.
There's too much directing here.
we have a medic?
Action! The French champagne has always been celebrated for its excellence. California champagne by Paul Masson, inspired by that same French excellence, is mine. I brought this in home. I wanted to eat my chicken. You tell me, I know a meal when I see one. There's no money and it's worth anything. You know, it's not my fault, old man. If they knew who I was, they should have asked me to direct the picture. I know how to deal with it. Is this the wine? Paul Masson. Yeah. You know, there is this California champagne that Paul Masson makes, and it's inspired by the best French champagnes. Like the finest French.
Oh, drunk Orson Welles.
I like it when he starts beating up the assistant cameraman or the assistant that just comes in with the fucking
leave
bread stick.
Food alone.
The breadstick and the fact that he had the chicken in his hand.
Leave it, it's mine! I brought it home with me.
I don't know if it's the fact that I'm incredibly sleep deprived or what, but that was freaking funny.
So maybe that's why you've been laughing at all our jokes. We're not really funny at all. You've just been sleep deprived, just driving for yeah, driving
probably.
For God knows how long from what was it? Chicago to where is it that you live again? I know it's close to where Dylan lives, right? Like statewise. Arkansas.
Statewise, everybody's close together.
Yeah, I knew it was Arkansas. It was like in the back of my mind.
Arkansas? What's it like in Arkansas?
Really, really dull.
Oh, I'm sorry.
And you can quote me on that.
Arkansas.
Really,
it's really, really, really dull.
See, that's what I love about...
That's going to be the promotion for this episode, I'm going to say. The SOS episode 31. It's really, really dull.
Well, that was one of the mind-blowing things to me. You know, living here, there's nothing to do, but, you know, staying with Billy DeBose in Chicago, we went everywhere. You know, I had, like, authentic Japanese cuisine, and we walked over,
through
Chicago. I got to see the sights and everything.
What was that, Adam?
Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't even know that Jake Baker was still talking. He was cutting out. I'm really sorry.
No, it's my microphone's crappy. I'm sorry.
No, but go ahead and finish what you were saying.
Apologizing. No, it was just, you know, it was so strange going from being in a place where there's nothing to do and there's no one around to being in a place where there's all these people and everything to do. It was like, this is heaven to me. And now I'm back here sitting in front of a computer talking to you two.
that's kind of like how we all felt after coming back from G-Fest. We were like, well, we're home.
Well, like, yeah, it's like we got done recording the Interstellar review at like 3 o'clock in the morning, and I come back and I die. And then something woke me up at 8 o'clock this morning, and I haven't been able to go to sleep then either, or since then either. So I'm like, I'm not sure what's real and what's fake anymore. I'm going to go that far.
When you start seeing salamanders climbing up the walls, odds are it's not real.
Well, everything I touch really is turning to shit. So... and thus this conversation has come full circle.
That should be the title of the episode, Everything Adam Touches.
Everything Adam Touches turns to
or no, you just leave it ambiguous, to leave it up to what just happens.
Everything Adam Touches, dot, dot, dot.
It all sounds depressing in a way, Everything Adam Touches. Dot, dot, dot.
Everything I touch, a memoir.
Yes.
It's a picture of me hurting like this, holding like this big pile of shit in my hands and just like crying. That'd be fantastic. I'd buy that.
That'll probably be how much it's worth. Actually worth.
I buy my own book. Adam.
Let's see. How long have we been at it so far? I think
like an hour.
Let's see. Sure. I did prepare some news, like little short news stories. Should you think it's time to go into them?
Let's talk about our random crossover.
Oh yeah, I forgot we had that.
A random crossover ideas because Andre's said on Facebook that. The new Attack on Titan Marvel crossover, which sounds fucking retarded. And so we started spitballing all of these random ideas. You mind if I pull up the conversation on Facebook?
I'm doing the exact same thing.
You're going to read yours, and I'm going to
okay.
read mine.
So yeah, I thought of having the idea of just bringing up like random, ridiculous, nonsensical crossovers that are even more stupider. Like... than Attack on Titan and Marvel. Just like straight up. Like, I came up with this idea where it's like, I was thinking of Attack on Titan or, like, Attack on Marvel, I guess, you know, we can call it that. Attack on Marvel. Dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun. So, I thought of, like, what if we had, like, a...
You guys are cutting. You're cutting out
oh, sorry.
A lot, Andres.
Let's...
It sounds a little bit better than Marvel on Blade.
Oh, that sounds a bit wrong.
The pornos.
So I thought of like, what if we had like the first thing that came to mind, probably in terms of randomness.
Andres, you're cutting out a lot.
Jacob, am I cutting out on your end?
Oh my God, he's dead.
See. Yeah, I'm here. Can you hear me? Can you hear me?
Okay. Yeah, you're still cutting.
The audio cutting out.
Okay, now I can hear you, Jacob.
I hear you now.
Jacob, are you there? Okay.
Yes, I'm here.
I can
hear
you,
me?
Yeah.
Okay. We can hear you. Can you hear me?
I can hear
me?
You perfectly clear.
I can hear both of you now.
That's not very hard, is it?
Okay, so as I was saying, I was thinking about Attack on Marvel, and I thought of, like, what if we had, like, even, I was thinking this random thing came to mind, and it's so random, I was like, yes. Norbit crosses with Daddy Daycare. Just randomness, like two...
God, you're cutting out again, Andre. It's really bad.
You're cutting out again.
Let's see. Oh, that's okay. How about now?
That's better.
Okay.
I can hear you anyway.
Let's see. Okay, cause Oh yeah. Okay.
Speak, Andre.
How about now? Am I cutting out again now? Hello? Yeah. Can
Andres?
You hear me?
Oh
hello.
My God, he's dead.
Oh, it's doing that thing again.
Oh my God.
It's doing that again.
Welcome to the newest installment of SOS, ladies and gentlemen. Technical issues.
Technical difficulties. The movie.
Okay, can you hear me now? Okay, because apparently, yes. You know how when you look at the upper left-hand corner of the screen, you see your little symbol that says, like, you're online or offline?
No, because I have Windows 8.
Okay. But, well, there's this thing that says, like, you're either online, offline, invisible, do not disturb. And that signal, it shows, like, a sky. Instead of showing the green with a check mark, it shows the, like, loading signal. So I guess whenever it's loading, that's a sign that says, like, you guys can't hear me. Yeah, so I'm going to quickly save. But the first thing that came to mind in terms of random crossovers was Norbit and Daddy Daycare. Two long-forgotten Eddie Murphy comedies just, like, meeting with each other for no reason whatsoever. Just like Attack on Marvel, only stupider.
And I shouted, Battlefield Earth versus Signs, a.k.a. John Travolta versus Mel Gibson.
I tell you what, mate, I want you to get off my singing planet. You couldn't hold your gun till you could spell your name. And then I came up with Daddy Daycare with Son of the Mask.
I would watch that one if it was on TV.
The creepy CGI.
I would not pay
creepy
money for
CGI
it.
CGI baby meets Eddie Murphy. Eddie Murphy's trying to take care of the...
Who is, in fact, himself a CGI baby.
Well, that's a good question. That is up for the philosophical books. And then I said, Nostalgia Critic versus Angry Video Game Nerd. Oh, wait a minute.
Because that happened. Yeah. And then I came up with Blade Runner crosses over with Mr. Magoo.
Then I said, yes! American Werewolf in London meets Adam Sandler.
So, like, Adam Sandler, he's in London. He's like, hey, you guys, can I have with you? He's like, and then he turns into the werewolf. Oh, my God, look at me. I turned into a werewolf. What's going on here? He's just doing the little Nicky voice all throughout the whole film. And then when he just talks the exact same way when he's a werewolf, only he just slobbers a lot. Actually, he pretty much sounds like the Tasmanian devil. And then I came up with Rocky versus Legally Blonde.
Which sounds amazing. So you have Rocky going, and then you have Legally Blonde going, well, I can tell you what Sylvester Stallone. What you need to do is get a good lawyer, and I am that lawyer. And then they start banging, and then we have, like, this weird porno going
Then it becomes the Italian Stallion 2.
Exactly. And then I retaliated by saying Alien versus Young Frankenstein. So basically, I can picture the Young Frankenstein team on the ship, on Ripley's ship from the first Alien film, dealing with Alien.
Dear God, I want to see that.
The Xenomorph is strangling Dr. Frankenstein, and they're doing the whole little, like, mime, charades.
Oh my God, yes.
And then he ends up teaching the Xenomorph how to play Putin on the Ritz.
I want to see this. Ridley Scott, listen, Ridley Scott. I know you're listening to us. Don't make Prometheus 2 and 3. Make Young Frankenstein meets Alien right now.
You can't do it without the cast, though, and half of them are dead.
We're great for shooting down our ideas, Jacob. Thanks for crushing our dreams. You already lived your dream of playing Godzilla on the big screen, and here you are just trying to crush what the little things that help us cling on to life. With our trying to destroy our delusions of grandeur.
My work here is done.
Well, this just got fucked up really quickly, ladies and gentlemen.
On a very emotional episode of the Sons of Serizawa podcast.
And then
I came up with Watchmen meets My Little Pony. And I can, I bet you, I'm gonna look right now to see if anyone's already made pony-fied versions of the Watchmen characters.
You know they have.
I mean, I've already seen a pony of David Tennant so far. Watchmen MLP. This is gonna be horrible. Oh my god, it's actually real! Oh god!
So much porn! I mean, no.
Oh god! It's real! It's real, Morty! It's real!
It's so terrible!
I mean, it's imagined it's creative as hell, but oh dear god!
Oh my god, yeah. Andreas, you're gonna
okay,
love
hold,
me.
I'm gonna show this to Jacob right now. I'm gonna send the link.
Oh,
I thought it was too random for it to exist, but it actually exists.
It actually exists.
Okay, what was it, Adam?
Andreas, look at the one that I just sent. You'll
where, on
it.
Facebook or the... Oh, here.
Yeah.
On Skype.
Okay, Rorschach Pony,
okay.
Badass.
Okay, that is actually really cool.
That is
yeah,
really
it seems
awesome.
Like it seems like a custom-made My Little Pony toy, and I think this may have came out around the time of the Watchmen movie, because this may sound weird, but you know, if the new MLP cartoon, the ponies are like redesigned from like the 80s ones, and this appears to be based on a toy of like the 80s ponies. It shows just how sad I am when I can tell the difference between different versions of ponies.
Thank God I don't give a shit. Then I said, because he wrote MLP for My Little Pony, I put MLK meets Orlando Bloom.
I don't even know how that's going to happen. Just like Orlando Bloom, does he... just Orlando Bloom in general? Or like, does he play a character during Martin Luther King Jr.'s...
No, he plays Martin Luther King.
So he's going to be in blackface the whole time? Does he keep like his British accent? I have a dream where white men and black men can live, when white children and black children can. That just so shows how sad I am.
Live together while taking the hobbits to Isengard.
Free at last. Thank God we are free at last. And then I came up with perhaps my favorite, Jurassic Park meets Teletubbies.
That, I love it. That needs to happen.
He just goes
happen.
Up to it like a T-Rex. Like, Tinky Winky! The T-Rex just... Yeah.
And then, last but not least, Reading Rainbow meets the X from Outer Space.
Someone just like... just like maybe work? Like the host from Reading Rainbow, Phil Lamar, was that his name? I know, because you're a Star Trek guy, and he was in Star Trek. Does he, like, reprise his role and then uses, like, the weird butterfly, animated cartoon butterfly from the intro to fight Gilala?
To fight Gilala,
I can do anything. Just take a look inside a book of Reading Rainbow.
You just see Gilala slap the butterfly down on the ground and step on it. And then turn into that random orb.
Oh, he's just...
All right, there's two random crossovers that I have always
okay.
wanted to see.
Shoot!
Ooh.
No, I wanted to see Care Bears versus Ewoks.
I wanted to see it so
I
bad!
I want to see like, the Ewoks just murder the Care Bears with their sticks and their giant log traps that they use to crush the AT-ST walkers. Like, boosh!
And they have, like, the spears and the crude weaponry, and then the Care Bear are shooting laser beams at them through their bellies,
they can
you know.
Take down, if the Ewoks can take down giant robots, I'm sure the Care Bears are a cinch compared to that. The Empire.
And the second crossover.
It exists.
What?
It exists.
Send the link.
It exists.
Show us.
It exists. Oh, the
French! The French!
I'm saving these pictures now because I'm gonna need to use this in the video.
What does it say? Care Bear stare.
I just love how like nonchalant the Ewok.
No, he just he's in like full 100% don't give a fuck mode.
Yeah, he's
got the
like...
look of Fred the Killer Emu. That. Okay, well, the other idea that I had, I can pretty much guarantee someone has done it. Smurfs versus Snorks.
Ooh. Oh, Robot Chicken did that, I think. Yeah. Yeah, I'm going to look for it.
See what happens when you don't have satellite for 8 years? This kind of crap happens, and you don't know about it.
This fucking shit happens. What the fuck am I looking at? What the fuck am I looking at?
I don't know what you're looking at.
Oh, my God. You guys, I don't know what I'm looking at, but it's definitely my kind of humor.
Okay, let's see. Oh dear God! It's Hiroshima in the middle of Smurf Village.
I know what that is.
It's Ralph Bashke. It's Ralph Bashke's version of Smurfs.
I think that's the last panel of like Deadpool killing the Smurfs.
Oh,
that's
okay.
Oh, thank
awesome.
You, Deadpool.
Because. That was fan. I love
like,
you, Deadpool.
Like, woo, fuck you, avatars. That's the wrong fiction. Wrong blue people, Deadpool.
Oh, there's a crossover I want to see. Deadpool and Red versus Blue. Because I know him and Caboose would get along so well.
Okay, so I just, Jacob, I just sent you the link to the Robot Chicken sketch.
Oh my God, Red versus Blue meets fucking Seinfeld.
I can see that.
Well, that sounds amazing. This here is my kind of Smurf, personally. This is what I've always pictured Smurfs really being.
Oh dear God, that is nightmare inducing.
Gizmo, caca.
You know what? This reminds me of a story I heard on another podcast where a bunch of people dressed up as Smurfs and robbed a convenience store.
I want to know right now whose bright idea it was to fucking do this. I can't even put the picture. It was like...
What? Someone like drew like this MS Paint little image of a snork.
A snork saying fuck.
With a
holding a penis.
It's apparently bleeding. Okay, I want to show you. Okay, here's an image from the security cameras of the Smurf gang trying to rob a convenience store.
Oh, send this shit.
Feast your eyes. Oh. The Smurfs turn ghetto. Yo, man, give us your blood. Give us your money.
This is fantastic.
All right, everybody. Everybody, be cool. This is a robbery. Any of you Smurf and Smurfs move, I'll execute every Smurf and Smurf and last one of you.
Don't Smurf. Don't even Smurf, or I'll Smurf you in the Smurf. What the snork?
And by the way, before we move on to another dumb crossover, I have a feeling that if Avatar 1 was based on the Smurfs, Avatar 2 will, since it's supposedly going to be revolving around the sea, will be an adaptation of the Snorks.
Oh my God! Yeah. Andres, feast
there is a
your
Smurfatar.
Eyes. Feast your fucking eyes. We've got Yowie.
Why? Why you do this? I'm not even gonna let the rest of this image load. No.
We've got Yowie.
Yeah,
we've
thanks
got
for the
Yowie.
Heads up there. I'm not even gonna click on it.
Yeah, we've got Yowie. We've got it.
Anyways, let's see. Crazy.
Well, it's too late.
Damn it. Okay, so crazy random crossovers. Okay, let's see. Let's see. Crazy random crossovers.
Batman meets,
Back to the Future.
The Crypt Keeper.
Back to the Future. There we go.
Shredder is just like dark brown. He's just trying to show Batman his time machine. Like, great Scott, Batman, I created a time machine. Like, you, where'd you
get? Just that line alone would make me want to see a great Scott, Batman.
It's like, where'd you get the energy? Where'd you get the plutonium? I got it from terrorists. You deal with terrorists. You're just as bad as them. Not my city. Then he just imagines like, we don't be using the, we should be using time travel, except only when I use it. I can only be the only one to use time travel, because I'm Batman. I'm smart enough to use time travel.
My fucking god, it really fucking exists. What? There is an entire thing on Tumblr dedicated to Smurf.
Oh, damn it. We got him on another kick. Adam, get the fuck off there. Get off. Now.
Adam, bad.
I'm going to squirt water on you. Adam, to hell with your shit.
Inspector Gadget and Death Note.
Whoa. So does Inspector Gadget play the part of L trying to track down Light Yagami?
No, I think Penny would be the one playing the part
of
Light.
Or rather, she's the real one while Inspector Gadget, he's trying so hard yet failing at trying to capture Kira.
Yes.
Well, let's see here. We have people dying left and right. How am I supposed to solve this matter? Hey, got it. Go, Gadget. Gadget magnifying glass. And just, like, does nothing but fuck around. Well, Penny's doing all the work.
Go, Gadget. I'm gonna go kill myself.
Go, Gadget. Plot device. what else? SpongeBob and Deadliest Catch.
SpongeBob and Evangelion. Fuck yeah.
Whoa.
SpongeBob.
Whoa, man. Whoa.
And SpongeBob's Evangelion is like an Evangelion except it has a Krabby Patty head.
So would the Sandy become like the Gendo of... No, she becomes the Ritsuko of this situation.
Yeah, Sandy's the Gendo.
No, and Mr. Krabs... No, Mr. Krabs... No.
Yeah, she's the Ritsuko.
Mr. Krabs is the Gendo. Because all he cares about is money.
No. It would definitely be... Yeah, no, Plankton would be sailing.
Okay.
Would be charming. This needs to happen.
And then SpongeBob, he has to pass a pilot's test to pilot his Ava, but he always fails it because every time he starts third, fourth, fifth, sixth, seventh, eighth impact, every time he tries to take his pilot test.
Which is why he always runs away. I like it.
So dear God, would like imagine Patrick being the Ray. No, Pat. No. It makes sense for Squidward.
Squidward would be.
No. Which one? Who gets more shit on? Who gets more like bad stuff happening to them? Asuka or Ray?
Oh, Ray.
Okay, so he'd be Ray because apparently in especially the newer seasons of SpongeBob, the universe is against Squidward.
Okay, who would be Asuka? Larry the Lobster would definitely be Misato's love interest. God, what's his name?
That guy. Who's he?
That guy. Who's he, McFuckit? Why can't I remember his name? But Larry the Lobster would be him. Who would be Asuka? Pearl.
Oh, yeah, perfect.
Pearl is
perfect. Nobody likes Pearl. At least
he likes Pearl, therefore Pearl's gonna be Oscar.
Oh my god, Daddy, you're embarrassing me! Well, just ends up crying.
Get your damn robot!
Well, you got me the wrong colored one! You must hate me!
Just get the damn robot. May I just say I love that line on Evangelion 2.0 where she's like, I miss the red. where she's going to pilot the Ava Unit 04. I just noticed that recent viewing.
Nice line.
I like that line. I thought that was a good character thing for
her.
Anyways,
back to random question. Why is her pilot suit the only one that matches her Ava's color? It always seemed weird to see, like, Rey and Shinji have their, like, suits not be the same color as their mechs.
Well, Shinji's has blue.
And Ava Unit 1 has no blue. I don't know. Whatever. Okay, let's see. Random crossovers.
Whatever. Yeah, let's get off
Starship Troopers.
Okay.
And Buzz Lightyear of Star Command.
Oh my god, yes. Oh my god, yes.
I would pay to see that.
I would pay to fucking see that.
Let's see.
He has to be like horribly inserted into the original one. We just see him like every once in a while, just kind of like as a DLC for the movie.
The Nightmare
Star Wars meets
No
Lord
no
of the
no
Rings
no.
Would
okay.
be interesting.
Star Wars meets A Nightmare on Elm Street.
Yes.
Where Freddy Krueger is he represents the dark side of the Force. He is the dark side of the Force.
I would pay money to see that, actually.
I would pay a lot of money to see that. So then I'd have to say Michael Myers in Star Trek.
He just goes around the Starship Enterprise quickly murdering people left and right.
And then the twist is you'd find out that Michael Myers is really William Shatner wearing a William Shatner
mask. I know, this is William Shatner.
Best plot twist ever.
This is William Shatner from the future, okay? So this is fat
go.
William Shatner.
So yeah, this Michael Myers used to be extremely overweight. I like this idea.
Let's see.
What would happen if Star Trek TNG and the live-action X-Men movies linked up? Because then Captain Picard would also be the brainy guy.
Professor X.
Thank you. What would happen?
Isn't Mighty W doing that crossover?
No, I don't think so. X-Men and that? No, I don't think so. I don't know.
Food for thoughts. Like, comment, and subscribe what you think.
While also liking the Sons of Serizawa Facebook channel or Facebook page on Facebook.
Ladies and gentlemen, we are not whores.
Well, come on, Adam, we gotta make money off this somehow. Making money for just talking out our asses.
I'm telling you make that Wrecking Ball t-shirt, that'll get you so much money.
And had the caption America underneath it.
Oh yeah, I forgot to bring this up. When we were talking about like food that makes you go America. A couple years ago, I was at the county fair in San Diego called the San Diego County Fair or the Del Mar Fair, and
so original.
That is so meta.
And I had fried Oreos, so I was eating fried. I was eating fried Oreos. I'm like, first off, I shared it on Facebook saying, yep, can't get more American than this. As I said to myself, yeah, fried Oreos. Fucking America.
Fucking America.
Okay.
Aren't they amazing? Yeah. Aren't they fucking amazing?
Also, by the way, fried Kool-Aid was a real disappointment.
Oh, really? I hadn't tried it yet.
Yeah, it's basically like that batter, that doughy, like, donut hole like batter with like food color like the powder that you would make to make Kool-Aid, and it barely tastes any different from like a regular batter of that stuff.
Damn,
it's a little pink.
I'm saving you from the disappointment. Andres, you just ruined my entire life. My entire life has been building up to trying the fried Kool-Aid.
Never try the Kool-Aid.
Let me tell you what, Jonestown was a big event, Andres, and I was lucky to make it out of there alive. I wasn't even alive in the 70s. Adam, what the fuck are you talking about?
We were talking about random crossovers.
Oh, yes.
Statue of Liberty versus that French arc that no no the let's see Statue of Liberty versus
the Ghostbusters. No. Oh wait,
Statue of Liberty versus Daimajin.
Fuck yes. So much win, and then we can have the Ghostbusters in there.
Yes,
still.
The Ghostbusters are piloting.
Because the Ghostbusters have to pilot the fucking
with their NES with their NES Max controller.
Exactly, because Daimajin is tearing apart New York City.
Yeah,
guys, we have a script here. Call us silent. Call
What's
up
the
Roger
song that
Corman.
They played in Ghostbusters 2?
Oh, I don't know.
Like Jacob, you were alive back then.
Wait, what? Wait, what?
Jacob, bail us out here.
When was that movie made?
Let's see.
Was it the 90s? Was it like 92?
Okay, well, yeah, I was around back then. Doesn't mean I watched it. I mean, I did watch it, but years ago.
Oh, yeah, certain anti-technology.
Let's see, 89.
Oh, 89. So I wasn't too far off. I was guessing 92.
Let's see.
Yeah, it's weird. I'm anti-technology, but I love video games.
It's weird.
Very strange.
That makes fucking sense at all. That makes no sense at all.
Higher and higher. That's the name of the song. I'm gonna look it up right now, so I can imagine. That song playing as the Statue of Liberty fights Daimajin.
I need to put that in the video. I don't care how much copyright bills. It's going on Bill's channel. Higher, higher. Another random crossover. Jacob, your turn.
I know, I'm still liking the idea of Star Trek, the original generation, crossing over with critters.
The original generation?
Yes.
I love the original generation.
So instead of the trouble with tribbles, the craziness of...
Be the trouble with brights.
Let's see.
I don't think you could possibly get any more 80s
I know.
This song.
It's so... No. I got a perfect one that... A perfect one that Dylan and I listened to as we were driving on the road to Dreef on the road again. What was it called? It go like, we gonna walk on to Electric Avenue, where we'll take it higher.
Okay, so this is totally going to be the opening credit song now. Shit, that means Jacob.
Yeah.
Do you mind drawing us a little something?
you know, you don't mind us drawing a little something, you know?
I still have yet to finish like half the shit Andres gave me to do, and your Titanosaurus.
I was joking.
No, I will very gladly draw anything you guys want me to draw. What's the idea? You want it to be Daimajin fighting the Statue of Liberty.
I do! So bad! I want Daimajin fighting the fucking Statue of Liberty! God damn it!
Alright, you got it.
That takes priority. This takes priority. That is going to be the cover of
this
episode.
This is a matter of life or death!
This is a matter of life or death, Jacob!
If you don't, everything will be ruined! Everything will be ruined!
So much rests upon my shoulders, I don't know if I'm ready
the
for this
universe,
responsibility.
The universe
now.
Demands it, so that when future idiots like us decide to search if whether or not this is a thing or not, they will realize it was a thing. And it was because of you, Jacob. You are the one responsible for making this a thing. Just like the person who made MLP Watchmen a thing. And they'll be questioning, why the fuck does this exist? You can be part of it, Jacob.
You can be part of it, Jacob. So, Jacob, you know what you're going to do as soon as this podcast ends? Other than go to bed?
and contemplate suicide?
This takes priority. This takes the absolute priority, Jacob. Fuck Titanosaurus. Fuck all of that shit. This takes priority.
Okay, I'll get to it first thing in the morning. And I just to be on the safe side, I did a Google search, and no one else has
yes!
done it.
Yes!
We can patent this shit! We're millionaires, boys. I'll share it with all of you. Why, in a few months, this movie's name will be up in lights on Hollywood.
Hey, everybody.
Dimension versus the Statue of Liberty.
Hey, everybody. We're going to get laid. Yeah.
Woo! Vaginas.
And I just sent you the link to the second most 80s song ever. Also, the most Jamaican song ever.
Oh, I've heard this.
It's the 80s. Do a lot of cocaine, vote for Ronald Reagan.
Well, Star Wars Project.
Yes, it's like that MST, did you?
Yeah, Big Avenue. I love that song.
I'm actually dancing right now to this song.
Oh, holy shit, Eddie Grant, yeah.
It's the higher and higher right now, thank you.
We're gonna rock on to Electric Avenue. And then we'll take it
higher. Electric Avenue. The only thing that I'm worried about is what am I gonna do... Oh, we can talk about this after. Andre, is any other crossovers?
Let's see.
The list just goes on and on.
Let's see. Titanic bot from the last episode of Shoe Watch.
Yes.
Meets, what the hell? Transforming Twin Towers.
No, I was thinking Sharktopus.
Okay, Sharktopus versus Titanic bot.
Sharktopus sounds awesome. Just think of the Titanic versus Sharktopus. You need to call Roger Corman up right now. We are the new. We become the new heads of Roger Corman Industries.
And we'll be the ones to have like. Well, we can't use Daimajin, so we're gonna make like Samurai Bot versus Samurai Man versus Statue of Liberty.
Yes, but for the sake of this episode, we don't give a fuck. It's definitely Daimajin.
Yeah.
Let's see another one. Let's see. Something that's stupid. Something random. Michael Phelps versus Shaquille O'Neal.
Go fucking kill yourself.
Why? Why?
No, I was just saying. Because I think it's happening.
What? Oh, no, wait. Oh, wait. Wasn't there like a... There was a show where Shaquille O'Neal would like challenge people at other sports. And then he would have, like, a little, like, whenever he challenged someone who was obviously better at the sport than he does, then he would have, like, a little, like, a handicap.
Yeah.
But no,
okay.
There's an actual show.
And it becomes a true underdog story.
Underdog versus the Crypt Keeper.
Whoa. Like,
where did this come from? This genius.
Like the creeper decided to bring like Underdog back from the dead, and then he.
I'm the Crypt Keeper.
Let's see. You know, for a dog, you're a real bitch. And then zombie Underdog decides to fight back against his master and fights against the Crypt Keeper.
I like it. I like this idea. I hope.
Yeah, I'm not hearing anything I don't like.
Let's see. Let's.
Somebody better.
Rod Sterling versus Alfred Hitchcock. Who has the better anthology series?
It's just them reading. It's them reading two completely different books, and it's just them having like a narrator off.
Take into consideration that certain story of Psycho, like.
Please take into consideration. That certain areas of Psycho is absolutely shocking to the masses, which is why I believe on the third day of this month, you should come see my new motion picture known as Psycho.
Well, you can take, Rod Sterling, can take your. I'm going to take your story and shove it up your ass. For my series, The Twilight Zone, certainly much more better than your little Alfred Hitchcock Presents. As you are about to enter the Twilight Zone. Da 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 da.
Excuse me, good sir. I bet you I could teach.
Well, obviously you've got me there, but at least I can see my own penis.
You got me there.
At least I can see my own dick.
Oh, you bastard.
Check in mate, good sir. I'm Rod Sterling.
The joke's on you. I have a vagina.
My relationship with my wife is quite complicated.
I thought you were gonna say a vagina, and then you were gonna like turn into like Alan Moore, and be like, "It's something need a penis with my serpent god."
I was trying to avoid Alan Moore serpent god, but in that case, we should have Alan Moore serpent god versus Cthulhu.
That just sounds terrifying. No matter what happens, we're fucked.
You want to be fucked by Cthulhu's tentacles or by Alan Moore's serpent god? Either way, it's certainly not pleasant.
Yes. I take my chances with Cthulhu first.
Well, yeah, he is he's a legit kaiju, and his creator is not insane. At least he's not publicly insane. He's not a complete hypocritical hipster. Let's see. Vincent Price versus Roseanne.
Oh my god! I would love to see this as a sitcom. Resurrect Vincent Price from the dead.
Resurrect and Roseanne's career from the dead.
The dead. And we've got this. However, I think the best and greatest crossover that hasn't been done yet, but will be
eventually... Will Smith versus Tom Hanks.
I thought they did a movie together.
I don't think so. No.
Did they?
I think so. I think the first movie Will Smith did was one with him. I could be wrong, and I probably am.
Yeah, Mr. Anti-Technology. I'm sorry if that offends you. I'll shut up if that offends you. I'm sorry.
Why the hell would that offend me?
I don't know, because you're Jacob Baker, and you're better than me in, like, every way, shape, and form.
You play Godzilla on the big screen?
You're just better than me. Fucking Christ. Like, the fact that you're stooping down to this low being on this fucking show is, like, beyond me, Jacob. You're just so much better than me, man.
Somewhere deep down in my heart.
Okay, but think about this. If you claim me to be so much better than you, then why is it that I love listening to you guys talk?
That's a good fucking question.
Let's see. Martin Scorsese versus Woody Allen.
Ooh.
Peter Jackson. Okay, I want to see Woody Allen fight someone versus Woody Allen versus
Woody Harrelson.
I was gonna say Mike Tyson.
Oh!
Oh my god! Yes. Oh my god.
Narrated by Don Fry.
Oh,
Don Fry needs narration.
And then Woody Allen said, "Oh my god, I'm like such a good fan of yours." And then. Tyson said, "Well, I've never seen any of your movies, but I'm a huge fan." This is fucking stupid, guys.
So, there you go. Takahashi came up to me.
You hate Takahashi. There's two things.
There's two things you don't know
about me. One is I can't remember Japanese names for shit, and the other is I don't give a shit myself.
I still want to meet him so bad, though. I do. I'm so jealous of you guys. Really?
You do until you find out that he listens to the podcast and he's just taking notes every time you guys make fun of him.
Like,
I'm going to beat the
shit out of him. Well, no, if he listened to this podcast and we find out that, we'd be like, fucking come on one day, man. Dude, just like randomly show up. And you need to say the science sound.
Dude.
Because it most certainly is not.
And then we just, like, have a little last bit of him who's like, "So where's my check?" I'm pretty sure because Jacob knows someone who works heavily in G-Fest, and that he can get like a connection stick for Don Fry to show up in our show.
I don't have that much power on.
Like, what was your friend? What was his name? Roberts? The person. Robert Scott Field. Imagine we have to translate everything John Fry says. He says he's very pleased to meet you. No, everything he says is Merca. Merca. He said, "What do you think of the situation in Libya, Don Fry?" Merca. He says he approves of Barack Obama's policies, but is not quite sketchy on certain aspects of his policies. Ah, I see. What do you think was the truth? How do you interpret the ending of The Graduate? Merca. he believes it is an introspective.
It's a heavily philosophical debate in which he refuses to take really a side of just because of the backlash he fears from the public. However, he does see it as a very ambiguous ending and actually appreciates that of the picture, it being a very sophisticated motion picture itself.
Is this true, Don Fry? Merca.
That is correct, yes. No, he has to belch and then he
Merca.
Don Fry.
Don Fry.
That's not actually him talking, it's actually the mustache.
The mustache is a mind of its own, right?
Oh my god, Don Fry's mustache versus Adolf Hitler's mustache.
Adolf Hitler's mustache versus Charlie Chaplin's mustache versus J. Jonah Jameson's mustache.
So that means Jacob on the picture of Diamond.
No,
versus
no.
Statue of Liberty.
No.
I guess that's a no. Okay.
Although, I will toss in the background just some mustaches fighting in the background.
Okay, yeah, you can
like
totally
random,
that.
Like Dragon Ball Z fighting in midair.
It would take forever and a day, but I could just do a collage of all of these different random.
Yeah,
battles.
Just do a collage of all these different mustaches. And they form a hidden message.
No, I think it was on the last episode of SOS. We came up with the idea of Don Fry's mustache versus Tom Selleck's mustache. Then
Sam Elliott's mustache.
To fight Sam Elliott's mustache.
The ultimate mustache.
Just a flashback to that Cyanide and Happiness short, the beard.
One mustache goes, Merca. The other mustache goes, sometimes there's a mustache.
Well, that was good.
It was.
Really.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Good night.
Andres,
I'd very much appreciate it if you just stop.
Oh, you're telling me to stop. You, of all people, are telling me to stop.
Andreas, I think it's time for the news.
Okay. Well, with what little news I have, apparently...
Okay, well, no. Hold on. Here is Andreas with the news. Okay.
Come on now, more margaritas.
Come on now, more margaritas.
Man, I gotta stop smoking crystal meth.